Welcome to the party. Welcome to the Apocalyptic Comedy Club here, where we have good humor, great insight, adamant statements. We enjoy the apocalypse, the unveiling. Everybody's on edge right now. Have you noticed that? They're snappy because the whole tone of the world is very snappy right now. They're very concerned. They're not sure. It's kind of like they don't know which way to go, you know, which candidate to vote for, so to speak. And the election's almost here, and we have to decide which way are we going, you know, truth or lies, which way are we going to go? This direction, is this happiness this direction or this direction? So it's a journey beyond words right now we're engaged in, journey beyond words. So words, we're a little, you know, we're snappy because we have to make a decision. We have to make a decision. So here we have this wonderful graphic. Trying to post one a day here, and you know, if you can get into this, you can just feel, here's Jesus walking along as he's coming down from the mountains, and he's in this little barrio, a little sort of a flash flood sand sort of area and he's walking along this between the rocks, and looks like there's somebody there looking at him, and here he comes just peacefully and calmly walking toward us, and he brings new wine. All right, very great. Welcome to the video. He brings new wine, and do not put the new wine into old wineskins. And that's what I'm helping out here, is to help us free ourselves from the past, and I can certainly help in that. Just because someone is historic is not definitive for me. It doesn't set the context at all. You know, I respect it because I've been someone historic myself in a past life. So I understand someone, you know, the dignity of someone who's done something at that time was considered very significant. But that, you know, I've done more this life than I've ever done all lives combined. So this life trumps all the other lives completely. And as I respect the work of those in the past, whatever they've done, it's all about what you're doing right now, actually. And we're called to do better. So, like for me, I've done better this life, way better. And so I'm not intimidated by all these historic figures, no matter who they are. So I can speak about it. Now, I've been talking about Christology, which the church was, you know, obsessed with for the first, maybe, you know, almost 8 centuries, really. Is trying to set their house in order and trying to fend off, you know, heresies. They were obsessed with the nature of Christ. Who, you know, what was this incarnation? What was this? And they decided on, there was two distinct natures, human and divine. And this is diaphysitism, two different natures, instead of monophysitism. But even monophysitism isn't the answer. All those physicisms have been giving people fits for 2,000 years, actually. The closest description of the truth is Docetism, which is, it was all a fantasy, it was all an illusion. Okay. Now, that was suppressed in the first century, and it hasn't really been heard from since, but that was actually the truth, as far as it went, is that there was no suffering, there was no person, there was no human, there was just one nature, which is divine nature. And in fact, we are all that already too. There's no real difference. There's no physis, stasis, whatever Greek word. They're all kind of intermingling, those Greek words. You know, that's a problem. There's so much confusion among the different Greek philosophies of Plato and Aristotle and the various Greek philosophers, which they use to try to formulate, you know, the what happened there with Jesus. And so it's so confusing. But Docetism was actually said, hey, don't worry about all that stuff. There weren't two natures. There's only one. So all this struggle about how to define two natures is much ado about nothing, actually. Much ado about nothing. Now, I respect the efforts they made, every single one of them. I don't care what their name is, who you want to call them, whether it's a church father, doctor of the church, or bishop, or, you know, whatever, pope, whatever. It doesn't matter. They made the best efforts they could make at the time. So much respect and love and admiration for their efforts. But Jesus calls us to do better. He absolutely has called us to do better. Of course, when miracles came in the world, it was really a challenge to us to do better. He says, you haven't got it yet. Pick up the pace. Take up this challenge. So that's what I did. I was determined to do that. And so I'm saying, hey, we don't need to put new wine into old wineskins. The old wineskins of a dualistic nature of Jesus, two natures, divine and human, is completely false. Completely false. The only difference, as I've said, between Jesus and ourselves is that we are still pretending to be dead and denying that we're pretending. We're pretending to be dead, and yet we're denying this, saying, no. We're, this is our nature. This is our physis, you know, like monophysitism. Physis was the nature, a set of characteristics that define, you know, the nature, the human nature. You know, monophysitism is just one nature, but that Jesus somehow combined the divine and human as he was incarnated, then has one nature, you know, that was like some sort of combination. Trichianthesism or something like that, where they have all sorts of funny words, most of Koine Greek, or, you know, the Greek words, philosophical Greek words, and they don't translate well to other languages. It's a mess. It's an absolute mess. Always has been. That's because they kicked out Docetism right off the bat. They said, no. Now, the Christology that people espouse really is a reflection of their own belief in what they are. You see, this is why they got it wrong. They said, everybody said, well, I'm a human. I got human nature, so I can't leave that out. You know, in other words, I'm dead, spiritually dead. I can't leave that out, because pretending to be spiritually dead is what we're doing, because we think that's the way to happiness, the only way, we think. Because we think we killed God, and therefore we have to die also, but we can fake our death, and by making an imaginary judge that we can deceive guilt, that we can deceive guilt by a fake death, and then guilt will say, okay, spirit died too, so spirit does have a superior will to God. And then since spirit has proven it has a superior will of God, then that must mean spirit says that it has the capacity then to resurrect itself from the dead and be the new prime creator. So we're all pretending to be dead, whereas Jesus was saying, look, in order to talk with you guys, I'm gonna imagine a body here, pretend to have a body, just like you're pretending to have a body, okay? But I know I'm pretending, okay? There's no pretense that I'm not pretending. Whereas you're pretending to have a body, but you're insisting you're not pretending, that somehow this is a physis, this is your nature. You know, there's a hypostatic, you know, the hypostatic nature of this, and then the underlying characteristics, you know, have made me this body. You know, this is false. It's pretense. So Docetism was very much in the ballpark, actually. All an illusion, a phantom. You know, the way they put it, they don't quite have the terminology we have right now to express it, but they were certainly in the ballpark, and they got crushed very early on, actually. It's extremely, completely unacceptable heresy. The only debate was, you know, how did the two natures, you know, express themselves? How is that possible? That's basically the debate. We said, we know we have two natures because we're certainly human, right? And so we know there's at least two. And basically they said Jesus had two wills, two separate wills. But how did they combine? Or, you know, what's the mechanism? So that's what all the debates were over, which was debate over nothing at all. There are not two wills at all. So all the questioning and theosophizing and theologizing and Christologizing and has been much ado about nothing. So we've just been spinning our wheels, basically, which is why we're so vulnerable to this technocracy that's taken over the world. If we were really wise, it would not have happened. The technocracy, we would have not allowed it here. So obviously, we didn't get it right, and the symptoms are, we can't ignore them, right? I mean, the Christians have to say, hey, wait a minute, you know, we haven't got it right. Look what's happening. You know, we messed up. Well, why? Because we insisted on two different wills. We insisted that there is such a thing as human nature, and Jesus tells us in A Course in Miracles that the body is wholly neutral. The body is wholly neutral, wholly. And what's most important about this statement about Jesus, where we have gotten in the worst problem, okay, is, now we have to get into this, and people go, you're like, I don't want to get into this, this is too difficult, you know, but we have to get into it. Jesus is speaking, remember St. Paul's letter to the Galatians says, we are neither male nor female, but we're spirit, Christ and spirit. What happened was, is the mind said, okay, we'll make a compromise with truth, you know, and say, okay, well, maybe men don't have the will of the flesh, don't have a separate will, but women definitely do. Okay, this is the idea of like, well, that men can have a neutral body, but women cannot, that there's a separate will in women, the will of the flesh, so that this continued pretense of producing bodies can continue. So the mind, the spirit is absolutely loath to admit that that female bodies are also wholly neutral, completely neutral. This is the sticking point. And that's why the patristic, apostolic, patristic Christology debates insisted on the Theotokos, which is the mother of God, Mary, which means that there is a separate will, a will of humanity, of flesh, that is came from Mary, mother of God. They insisted upon it. See, this is the big mistake that they made. Because they tried to split it both ways. They tried to have it both ways, which is typical. This is what Jesus came to tell us in the Course in Miracles. He says, hey, very lovingly, gently, look, you haven't got it yet. You tried to have it both ways. That doesn't work. That's all that Jesus is saying. It doesn't work. We're trying to drive it both ways. You can't serve two masters at once. You'll be disloyal to both. You can't go two different directions that are mutually exclusive at the same time. Okay? You can't find happiness where it can never be found. So this whole the Christology debate is kind of like arguing about which numbers are more like zero. You know, which numbers are more like zero than the others. So someone says, well, three is more than, and someone says 80 is more. Someone says, you know, 8, no, 10, 27, you know. And so we're having all this big debate of which number is similar to zero. Well, the answer is none of them are. They're all equally dissimilar, actually. And that's the end of the debate. So Jesus knows this. And so this is a new dispensation that's happening now. We're not trying to graft this new dispensation onto the old dispensation. We are simply setting it down altogether, and at least how I see it, really. We'll see how it works out, but there's no attempt. I'm not trying to graft this onto anything, even Docetism, but I'm just saying that Docetism was really in the ballpark, okay, as far, and of course that left out the will of the flesh, left out the mother of God, left all that out. And people said, no, because what, we don't, not sure where we'd find happiness. You know, I think maybe by faking our death, that might work. So we got to keep believing in that too, but we'll also believe in that we're inherently divine too, you know, but how to reconcile them. Oh, the hypostatic union. We just kind of invented this somehow reconciliation that we don't understand, that we can't see it, you know, but mystically it's there, you know. The Eucharist is some mystic reconciliation between these mutual exclusive directions, you know. This is folly. This is nonsense. Now, and so the sacrament, in large extent, was used to simply provide this somehow hypostatic union, some mystery of how the impossible happened. Well, guess what? It didn't happen. You know, how two separate wills are made one, the Eucharist is supposed to solve that mystery. There is no mystery. There's only one nature. So there's no reason, there's no call for reconciliation, somehow resolving this difficulty, you know, between the two wills, the will of humanity and the will of men. Men, there aren't any two wills. God has not paid the slightest attention to all our silliness, you know, of believing there's two wills, believing that we can die, you know, believing that all, he hasn't paid any attention to any of this silliness at all. He knows, God knows exactly what we are, because we're an idea in the mind of God, and God, there's only one will. There can't be any other idea of what we are, actually. So all this idea that somehow we need to reconcile our will with God's, there's no reconciliation because there's no separate will at all. So we just need to overcome the continuity fear, that what's really blocking us is the continuity fear, not the trying to find some hypostatic union of two separate physics, as it were, substrates of being, that somehow there's two different wills and they have to be somehow unified. Are they where we are? We're unified in the person of Christ. You know, this is nonsense. Nothing needs to be unified. There's only one will. So, yet we still feel there's a problem. So if we don't understand it's the continuity problem, we will go back into Christology and figure out how do we use the two persons of Jesus, which is what Christianity has been believing for all this time, which is why it made it vulnerable, this world vulnerable, to technocracy. And of course, dualists also, I mean, the religion in general has led us to be vulnerable to it. But I'm just using the example of Christianity as a, because technology has taken root in Christian countries primarily to begin with, right? Because they were vulnerable to this. So Jesus comes back and gently reminds us that, hey, you haven't got it yet. And of course, we're all boastful. What do you mean I haven't got it yet? You know, this is, I mean, I've been through it. I know exactly what it's like. And so I just need to brush up a little bit here. And then he said, wait a minute, maybe this is more than I expected. And we all think that, oh, well, we're pretty close. We're in the ballpark. No, we're not even in the ballpark at all. I mean, this two nature teaching, the Chalcedon, you know, creed of two natures is not even in the ballpark at all. Completely diluted, completely missing it. And then this torturous attempt to, you know, figure out how the two wills, you know, are one. Do they become one? When do they become one? Were they intrinsically one, but separate, some mysteriously separate somehow? I mean, this has just occupied, you know, the last couple thousand years. And it's all been a waste of time. It's all been a waste of time. So how can you, you know, humble yourself and realize, wow, it's all been a waste of time? Well, it's not easy, is it? So you have to give the benefit of the doubt to Jesus. You know, I gave the benefit of the doubt. Said, "Wow, I'm frustrated. It must be my own, you know, pride." Like saying, "Hey, wait a minute. At least some of the work I did must be right." And then you find out, "Wow, none of it." The only good thing that came of it was the discipline. Now, I always think I must have had, you know, Jewish lives in the past, because The purpose that I see that the Jewish people was is there was sort of like a push in this world. There was a push to try and develop a momentum towards recognizing the truth. And what the Jewish people did was they decided they were going to go along with that. Okay. And the reason for all the Jewish purity laws and all this kind of stuff, all this stuff was designed to try and lead the mind away from acting on impulse towards reason, towards reasoning and resting in reason. Say, wait, let us not act upon impulse. Let us take some time here and ask the Holy Spirit, ask reason, turn to reason. So the way that Jews did this was they had all these laws and restrictions, etc., and you couldn't do anything. You couldn't act on impulse. If someone said, "I think that might be," you're acting on impulse. The law says you cannot act on impulse here. Then it goes through the various courts and legal systems, and everything is just attempt to tone down impulse, and turn you towards reason. So you have these scholars, Jewish scholars. I mean, they're studying the law, you know, their whole entire lives, so many of them. And so they can judge and say, okay, what happened here? Well, let's look at it this way, and let's look at it this way, and look at it this way, and what's the most reasonable way to look at it here? Instead, whereas the other people, the pagans, are teaching each other to act on impulse. You know, if it feels good, do it. Just is an impulse, do attack, just attack. Someone angers you, kill them. You know, this is the way the ancient world was. And in a lot of ways, you can say this entire modern civilization is being pushing us to act on impulse. It's setting the wrong tone completely for the world. The music, if you listen to impulsive music, it's instead of leading you to reason, it's leading you to impulse. And all the content in pop culture is very much propagandizing you towards acting on impulse. Very, very much so. Whereas the austerity of listening to reason says we're not doing anything on impulse. We're going to sit here quietly for 20 minutes. You know, this is called repentance. This is called forgiveness. Is let us allow reason to let the clouds of impulse, you know, part, you know, be evaporated, and then let's get to reason, and let's say, hey, wait a minute, you know, there is no victimization. Now, back to bodies being wholly neutral, that means there's no such thing as victimization either. And so this is what's happening, is what we did was we insisted, no, okay, if we're gonna go, let's please both God and the ego. We'll say, okay, the male can be reasonable, okay, and can see their body as neutral, not act on impulse, but the woman, she must act on impulses, okay, she must, her body is not wholly neutral. And this is the ego that is deciding this for us. It's not men that are deciding, it's the ego, who try and make this compromise, which is our own arrogance, spiritual arrogance. So you can't say, well, it's just there's a sexist plot against women. No, that's not true at all. In fact, women insisted upon it. Says, no, we can't go with reason. We have to believe that our body is not wholly neutral. Otherwise, we might not be interested in having children anymore. We have to say that we're forced into it by our own nature is compelling us to do this. It means the body, the female body, is compelling us to act in these ways. And of course, this then gives them license to act in any egoic way they want to act in, which is why they developed the whole so-called psychic realm, which is a subtle manipulation, very clever, subtle manipulations of men to get them to pretty much do what they want to do, because my body, I can't help it. These are the appetites of the body. These are the impulses. I have to have those satisfied, or else I'm not going to be happy. If I'm not happy, you're not happy. You know. In other words, we need to be dead to spirit, and we need to succeed at being dead to spirit before we can convince guilt that we paid the price of killing God, that we too died, and that we legitimately did kill God because spirit died too, which would be a necessary corollary of the death of God. And so that then we can be resurrected and say, okay, our will is greater than God, then we can be resurrected into being the new prime creator. So we feel the ego, we have to keep this alive. So we said, okay, but we you know, God's pressuring us to let go of this folly. So we'll allow the men to listen to reason, but the women have to be continued to be act up on impulse. So what we have in this new feminist goddess-based culture is impulse culture. And this is what's being celebrated. It's a new world religion. As I say, it's a lipstick culture. You know, being supported by the pajama boys, basically. So, yeah, of course. And they've given up their own reason. They're trying to act on impulse as much as possible. Whereas the Jewish tradition was designed to lead us to contemplation as much as possible and not impulse. So Jesus came within the lineage of Judah, of the Jews, for son of Jacob, and came out of that lineage, which is lineage of let us appeal to reason. Now, even the sacrificial atonements the Jews were done, if you can look at it a way, is instead of slaughtering one another, they would slaughter an animal. So it was a way of leading the Jews away from impulse. Now, St. Paul, letter to Galatians, says, look, the law was only a temporary expedient of God, okay? But now we have the full what the law was leading us towards, which is truly reasoning in Christ Jesus and accepting this truth. There's only divinity, really. Now, Paul struggled with this, you know, dualism in himself, too. He wasn't he hadn't completely resolved it, but he was trying. So what he says to the Jewish people and the Jewish tradition was that was a temporary thing. And this is really important, is the law was designed to temporarily lead us away from impulse, and then once we're far enough away from it, then we can actually turn to reason, forgiveness, and the Holy Spirit. And at some point, we have to turn to the Holy Spirit, which will explain and resolve the whole situation for us. So you're not supposed to get stuck on the law forever, which is why Jesus was the Messiah of the Jews, actually. But some rejected him, some did not. Some insisted, no, we got to keep going with the law, and that's the answer. So sacrifice, having a sacrifice, instead of the Jews, you know, killing one another for the upset that they have, you know, he said, I did something wrong. I need to, instead of taking violent, impulsive action, I'm going to go to the priest, and the priest is going to sacrifice on my behalf. He's going to do the violence for me, okay? And the violence is going to be meted out upon a pigeon or something instead of on a person. So you can see in this context that the whole Jewish experience was designed as a temporary expedient to lead us, our mind, away from impulsive action, okay, which is egoic, fear-based action, towards contemplative reasoning this out. Let's convene this, and let's listen to this side and this side and this side, and have a wise elder, you know, schooled in all this, decide for us what is going to be the answer to this. And so you can take a look at that way. Glass is half full when you look at it that way. So I must have had a lot of experience in that, because how can I spend my entire life just sitting like in a room, focusing mentally, taking no impulsive action hardly at all, or minimizing it to an extraordinary extent, and just carefully sorting this all out, you know? This is a mind that has vast experience in doing this. There's no question about it. And getting it just right. In the previous life, I was a musical composer, and I spent, my entire life composing music, where you have to get everything meticulously right, in a piece of music. It would take years and years and years sometimes, sometimes a decade or more, just one piece of music to make sure everything was exactly right before ever anyone even heard it. Okay, so I had this, like a hermit-like discipline, and I've lived this life like a total hermit. Now, not completely. Sometimes you feel like, oh, I want a little impulsiveness, just because when in Rome, do as Romans do. You feel a little bit too much out of the norm of society if you're just a complete hermit, So I try to live a life that seems, at least pretends to be somewhat impulsive on superficially, and so I intentionally did that. I said, wow, I can't just be a complete hermit. People think I'm crazy. I need psychiatric help or something. Why aren't you interacting with people? Well, because I'm trying to sort out this entire, Judeo-Christian tradition and come up with the answers. How do we go forward? How do we go forward? So that's what I've done. So certainly the Jews have now the problem with that, doing that, the Jews, you have to be careful to keep going along to understand truth. And don't then use the ability to sort things out with reason tremendously to gain an advantage in society as far as business goes, because if you do that, you're going to become extremely successful and end up dominating, which a lot of Jews have actually, is they went that direction with their understanding of the law. They were able to dominate the legal system, and when you're able to dominate the legal system, you're able then to become extremely successful in business. For example, one thing with Donald Trump, for instance, he's is in the news so much, and I suspected. I said, look, he's playing a role to bring a lot of stuff to light. That's fine, but don't become too enamored, because I guarantee you that he's got a pack of wolves for attorneys. I guarantee you. Nobody is successful. Nobody's able to speak like he's speaking unless he has a pack of wolves as attorneys. And then one of his attorneys was on a show just recently. It came to my attention where he threatened a reporter who had, of course, you knew they were going to have rape allegations against Trump. I said that would happen. I'm telling people, just wait. Very soon, they'll be accusing him of rape. That's how they work. These people are in control right now. If you are scared, if you scare them, they will automatically, they'll bring up rape allegations against you and brand you as a rapist. That's standard operating procedure for them. So there it is, right away. His wife accused him of rape, and then this attorney was defending him. One of his attorneys was defending him. And the attorney then got furious with the reporter and said he's going to sue him, he's going to destroy him, take him from every penny he's never even had, and he's going to ruin his life. And this attorney, you can see, he's absolutely vicious. All right, Jewish attorney, very vicious, this one, the particular one. And big surprise. Now that Trump has a pack of wolves as attorneys, of course, Trump sues people all the time. And just as the POTUS also has a pack of wolves as attorneys, they all do. You don't go up to high position in this world right now unless you have a pack of very vicious attorneys who just can scare the heck out of anybody who gets in your way. This is how it is. And so you have these people who have a long tradition of studying the law. Their purpose was to help us move us towards forgiveness, reconciliation, and reason. But a lot of them got tempted by the powers of the world. The business person comes to you and says, hey, look, I'll give you like 5% of my empire if you just crush everyone legally that stands in my way. They said, wow, that's a pretty good deal. Maybe I'll take it. And that's what happened to a lot of the Jews, got into that sort of symbiotic relationship with the world, and that's a huge problem. So now there's this interlocking legal world that basically runs things. I mean, you cannot run afoul of that, or they'll crush you legally. So, the real Jews were supposed to continue to use the benefit that they had from this long effort towards turning towards reason to befriend Jesus, actually befriend Jesus, and this is what I have done. I haven't made a penny out of any of this. I have not allied myself with any moneyed interests at all. And this is the path, of course, of renunciation that you're supposed to take. You're supposed to use your capacity for reason to advance the overall clarity of the situation for everyone, instead of becoming filthy rich and driving a sports car, you know, and supporting the, you know, your family in a lavish lifestyle, which, of course, many women claiming that their bodies aren't wholly neutral insist the only way they can be happy is to satisfy all the lusts of the flesh, all the vanities of the flesh, and so the man is requires, you know, pressure, you know, to do that. So I mean, you know, this is a standard thing. A lot of men, you know, feel like I don't have any time for reason, you know, because I'm under pressure. I got to satisfy. If my wife's not happy, I'm not happy. So I've got to. And the wife insists that their female body's not wholly neutral. Will insist in that it has independent nature, will, and that there's no way that she can be happy unless all the vanities of the flesh are satisfied. And so then the man is then pressured severely into, you know, making a relationship with business world, the moneyed interest of the world, and oftentimes it's legal counsel, because, you know, I could have been a fantastic lawyer. People told me that. They said, you could just be an absolutely stunningly great lawyer, which is true. I could have been. And, but I decided no. I mean, thank God the Holy Spirit said, no, you've got to take up this higher challenge. And I did. Very difficult, very, you know, frustrating, because, you know, the world looks at you and says, you can't do anything for me, especially the women saying, you can't do anything for me. You don't have any money. You can't satisfy the vanities of my flesh. And I would tell them, there are no vanities of your flesh. And they'd say, well, the hell with you, you know. you're crazy, you know, that kind of, or we're going to just completely ignore you. Yeah, I was threatened for sure. When I've been threatened, mostly by the women. You know, we'll sick our lawyers on you. They say, we'll sick our men on you. You know, and I said, well, go ahead, sick them on God. You know, because that's who you have to sick them on. Hurry up, too. Don't waste my time. So, the situation is very intimidating for everybody, right? Because we're legally intimidated right now. We're under extreme legal intimidation. Everybody. I mean, I go outside the door and I think about doing something. And I say, wait a minute. What are the legal implications? You know, like, let somebody's picking my fruit tree, you know, picking the fruit off my fruit tree. Can I take a video of them and then post their picture and say, hey, stay away from my fruit tree? Oh, no, I'll get sued. You know, anything you do to try to protect yourself, you'll get sued. You know, this is the attitude. We're all extremely cowed by this intense legal situation where business people have employed some very, very shrewd, intelligent lawyers to, you know, bully and intimidate anyone who opposes the business interest, the business. So this is a very, very, very bad situation in the world. And of course, people are grousing about it. Of course they are, you know, and this has been going on for a long time. And so this is the downside of being very disciplined and developing reason is it can go bad. You can go bad. There's no question about it. And many have. But if you use your reason for clarification of truth, then you can go very, very, very good. Exceedingly good. Absolutely. To the point where you're able even to hang out with Jesus as a friend. And you're not struggling with the two nature things. Well, wait a minute, how do I, you know, you don't have that in your mind at all. That's the thing. I mean, I don't suffer from that anymore because of a lifetime of working to overcome this. It's not, I don't suffer so badly from it. I mean, there's still some echoing of it going on, which is frustrating. But what can you do here? I mean, the situation is so totally messed up here. So, you know, some Jews accepted Jesus as the Messiah, some did not. And the ones that did not have, to some extent, ended up, you know, sort of this in this symbiotic relationship with the world, really being, you know, very powerful behind the scenes, but, you know, sort of being behind the scenes and not out front so much. Banking is a similar thing too, right? I mean, your money changing, banking, all that kind of stuff that requires a very rational, very reasonable mind, but can also be used to accumulate massive power and wealth, see? So the real Jews, we call the tribe of Judah, the king of the tribe, the lineage that Jesus came from, are, the focus is to stay on spiritual truth. Use your reason to discern the ultimate truth of the situation. This is what you're called for. This is what your purpose is. This is what Jesus' purpose is. So people wonder, well, how in the world can I say I've met Jesus or hang out with Jesus? Well, just look at my background, the whole background, not just this life, all the lives here. And then look at this life. How did I use my reason? See? And when you use reason the right way, it's very powerful. And can you can come to completely dissipate, the confusion. And in that way, you can say you've dissipated the historic confusion that has been present. And I don't care what doctor of the church, I mean, they use St. Thomas Aquinas, the Roman Catholic Church certainly uses St. Thomas Aquinas as the ultimate doctor of the church. And, whatever he says or doesn't say, truth still remains the same, and truth can be very simply stated, right? What we're trying to do doesn't work. Trying to figure out a way to be greater than God simply is nothing. There's nothing to it. And God has never paid the slightest attention to any of it. Doesn't need to. God knows what we are. God doesn't say, "Well, I need to know what my son thinks he is," like that. No. I got to pay attention. My son has got some weird ideas of what he might be, and I really need to follow this. No, God is not following any. Has not followed any of this storyline. Okay, and I've said that. That the God that most of us have been praying to is this imaginary guilt that this judge that we have invented, we needed someone to judge our death, to say, oh yes, spirit did die. So then spirit can say, okay, that means that I did kill God, because if I killed God, I killed spirit too. But how do I know the spirits have been killed? If I'm dead, if I'm annihilated, I'm annihilated. How do I know it? Well, okay, I invent this judge, guilt, who is able to judge whether I've died or not. And then when this feeling of guilt is satisfied, feels okay now, that means that spirit has died. But we just simply completely invented this out of thin air. There's no will behind this whatsoever. It's a fabrication of our imagination, nothing more. So God is not paying any attention to this. He knows that we cannot fabricate some other will. We cannot change the will of God. But God knows that we've engaged in this silliness, but not following the silliness, doesn't need to. It's like saying we're arguing about which number is more like zero. Is God following our arguments and saying, wow, now they're talking about 10 being more important? Wow, I wonder what the sun is going to come up with next. 13. Okay, now it's 13. Then it's 22. Is God like all wrapped up and okay, now they're what number are they going to choose next? No, God's paying no attention to this whatsoever. It's zero. Zero is zero. There's zero effect upon God. Our attempt to change the will of God had zero effect. Zero. So, and all this silliness of trying to pretend to be dead, God knows it's all pretense, 100%. There's no judgment. God doesn't need to judge. He just all, God just simply knows that we are exactly as God created us. So it's not judgment. God doesn't need judgment. God has knowing. So God never goes into judgment, except we could say that from our standpoint of continuity, using concepts, we could say, well, there's a final judgment. The final judgment is just to accept that there's never been any judgment. Final judgment is we don't need judgment. It's the last illusion that gets rid of all other illusions and then realizes itself is no longer necessary. After having done that, it says, okay, and I'm not necessary either. So I'm absolutely within my rights to, make commentary on history, historical considerations. Absolutely. Jesus calls us to do better right now than we've done before. So if we're doing better than we've done before, then why cannot we comment on what's come before and say, look, that wasn't good enough. So that's all I'm doing. I'm saying, look, all this effort we made in the past wasn't good enough. I don't care who the person was historically and how, revered they are by any tradition. They didn't do good enough. They were still trying to do the impossible and, throwing up so much gibberish around it that people kind of said, wow, I mean, I can't figure out what they're saying, but if everyone agrees that, let's just call this good, then they'll agree too, and let's call it good. That doesn't cut it. Does not cut it at all. And so you can go through a lot of those you know, tomes of, you know, Kant and Aquinas and all these various philosophers and theologians and everything like that. And you come away, your head is just spinning. Say, my gosh, this is torture. You know what? Okay, I'll just agree that they must have come up with the answer somewhere. Somewhere it's in there. We're not really sure where. And everybody else will say, yeah, me too. I think that, let's just say that they've got it. They got the answer. And then we all agree and say, let's call it good. And we think because we agree that somehow truth is at the mercy of consensus, that we just take a vote on it, that's it. So there's really a lot of us like that. You know, it's just like this torturous, you know, work that they did and just trying to say, you know what? You don't want to read all this stuff. Just call it good. And people say, okay, you got it. But it's not torturous. We just say this is all pretense. It's very simple, actually. When you see truth, it's very simple. Spirit wanted to be greater than God. Spirit then tried to change the will of God. And to successfully do this, it would actually mean that God would be annihilated, but Spirit would be too. So Spirit, seeing no effect in God whatsoever, says, well, the reason why there's no effect in God is because there's still Spirit. I'm still here. So how do I have a superior will to God and yet succumb to my own decree that I be annihilated? This is a tough problem. We'll say, oh, I think I have the answer. Let me pretend to be dead, and I'm going to make a judge that can judge whether I'm dead or not. And when I'm truly dead, then this bad feeling will disappear. It was called this feeling of guilt. Will then disappear. When that feeling disappears, that's the judgment that I did kill God. And then to prove that I had a greater will, and therefore I can use a greater will to overcome my own death, the death of God and Spirit, because I have a greater will, which can now resurrect Spirit from the dead, and I will be now have this new life, a new, be greater than God. This is very, very simply. You know, that's all you have to really look at. So we're just like frantically trying to get this guilt to judge that we're truly dead. You know, except there isn't any such judge. And our frustration is that we didn't do anything at all. And we feel, we interpret this as we need to prove that we did, you see, instead of just accepting, oh, okay, we didn't change God at all. That's the end of it. It's a silly idea. It cannot be experienced except as, you know, just that no experience arises, the experience of not having an experience, which is not really an experience, like a judgment that there is no judgment, nothing to judge. Instead of that, we are still going along with a scam, trying to, you know, think that we have a way. Well, it's not a way. It's not a way. So we don't have to make it a way. There is a way. And just simply accept the final judgment that there is no judgments to make. The final pretense, instead of pretending to be dead, we pretend to be eternal life. That's all. It's the intermediate step that the Holy Spirit has for us. Vision of the Holy Spirit, vision of time, Holy Spirit's judgment of time is simply that there is no time. It's a judgment. The eternal moment, the holy instant, it's called. Well, it's like all time is judged as simply there's one holy instant. That's still the judgment upon time. And from that, we can realize there never was any time in the first place. But we can't really get to that directly. It's too frightening for us, continuity fear-wise. So, yeah, I am saying what I'm saying. I really am saying it. I'm saying all this stuff, last couple thousand years, we don't need it. We don't need it. It was a side trip. It's a side trip. And Jesus knew we would go on a side trip. There's no doubt about it. He said, you're not going to understand this stuff right off the bat. You're going to get on all sorts of side trips, but eventually you listen to the Holy Spirit, and I'll come back and help, you know, clarify it. And at that point in time I come back, there are some that will get it, and we'll help, you know, clarify the whole situation for you. And so he knew that we'd go on a side trip, the two-nature side trip, by epheticism. But he knew it. And we did go on a side trip. And now, you know, the friends of Jesus are back here helping him out, saying, no, this is always a side trip. And we now set it down with respect for our creativity, respect for our initiative, respect for all our efforts, etc. Absolutely. And not condemning any of it. I'm not condemning any of it. I'm just pointing out it's time to set it down. It's the end of the church age. Church age was a side trip. It was a side trip. Right, and again, I can say this. I am saying it, and not in a mean-spirited way at all, because I was part of the whole efforts too. In some way, for sure, I must have been to figure it all out. And I know how difficult it is to figure it all out. It takes extreme dedication. You put your impulses aside. You've got to put your impulses aside. It's more and more and more and more and more severely, more and more severely, and it's difficult. Yeah, it's very challenging, supremely challenging to do it. So, you know, it's not any surprise that it's been difficult, and that there have been many half measures, you know, compromise positions taken, many. And then those who just make it all so confusing, people just to say, hey, you know, we can't even, not going to even bother sorting through all what you said. If the church says you're good, we'll accept you're good, you know. It's too difficult. It's a difficult, I mean, you can't really sort through it all, you know. At the same hand, you've got to realize it's not true. So how do you do that? It's very difficult. So you have to go kind of seemingly indirectly, which takes a massive amount of faith, which is what I had to do. I had to go indirectly. And that was supremely difficult because I felt like I don't have anything to say. I can't stand up to these, you know, people who insist, well, it's all good. We're excited. This is good. And you can't refute it. Well, I couldn't refute it directly, but, you know, in the way they wanted to. But I refute it now by just simply saying what the truth really is. And then just saying that the massive complexity went into was simply obviously unnecessary, whether it was there or not. We need to get to a much more streamlined position of it. And they did not deliver an elegant, truly streamlined, clear exposition of truth at all. And they can't argue with that. It's not arguable at all. So, but in order to do that, you have to present an elegant, streamlined clarification. Otherwise, there's nothing, you know, you have no ground to stand on. So, you know, very, very difficult. Having to go at it indirectly, which required, you know, just massive discipline. Which is what the whole experience of putting yourself under the discipline of you know, the purity laws and all that kind of laws and stuff, is that you have to be able to, you know, sort through massive amount of complexity without jumping to impulsive edicts, you know. And, oh, this is what's right, this is what's right. So, I mean, what the Jews kind of rejected Jesus did is they kind of said, well, you know, we still have to sort through a lot of stuff before we get to it. And they did not say, we cannot impulsively accept Jesus, you see. That's not our way. So that's not entirely wrong. I mean, because those who did impulsively accept Jesus, a lot of them got it wrong. So it's an interesting thing, wasn't it? So it was an argument over means, you know. I mean, ways and means, and you know, like Paul was prosecuting Christians, said, "Wow, hey, it's way too impulsive. They're leaping to conclusions here. Jesus is the Messiah. You know, we're saved." And then they said, "Hey, wait a minute. The law says we're not supposed to be so impulsive like that." So he was prosecuting the Christians. And then Jesus said, "Hey, Paul, you know, look at it this way." And then Paul said, "Oh, wow. Now I see a different way of looking at it. That ultimately, you know, the laws are a means to an end, but they're not an end in itself. And that we do need to take up this higher challenge of accepting the end in itself here. So, you know, Paul is exhorting people to look at it that way. And, you know, pulling out his hair, whatever hair he had left, is so difficult. It's difficult. I mean, so, you know, the discipline that legalism gives rise to, that discipline can then be used to turn to reason, which comes from the Holy Spirit, actually. So that's what I did. I said, okay, let's do it your way, Holy Spirit. And then the Holy Spirit showed me how to get past legalism, how reason transcends legalism, but the discipline of legalism is valuable, you know, to use that in being very disciplined and not going, leaping to conclusions. You know, basically say, let's not apply the law until we're certain what the law is. You know, there's a restraint. And the Jews had to undergo a lot of restraint in their actions and decisions, etc., because they say, we don't know the full clarity of the law yet, so let us not take any action on this yet. But what they kind of got into is, well, we're never going to know the full clarity of the law, or it's unknowable, and that's not true. That is not true, because the full clarity of the law, actually, reason reveals that unto us. So with Jesus, basically fast-tracked, you know, got started with some of the Jews fast-tracking them. And then some of the Gentiles joined in, but meaning the Greek philosophers, who were also very prone to reason. And the symbiosis, synthesis of those two, you know, was the fast track of what Christianity was supposed to be all about. And if it has fast tracked us, great. But now is the time when we need the evidence of that fast tracking. The fruit has to become evident. You can't just perpetually say, well, you know, we know we're not close to it, and it's too far off, and we can't get to. Can't decide one way or the other. It's like there's an election coming. You have to decide one way or the other. You got to vote. You know, is it impulse or reason? Which way are you going to go? And if it's reason, you have to realize that reason does reach a conclusion. Absolutely, it does. Reaches a decision. That's this whole point of it, whole purpose of reason. So law is just kind of a sideshow of reason, actually. But it's a way to kind of overcome the continuity fear towards reason. And then once you get into reason, you realize that it transcends the law. Law is like a stepchild, sort of, that helped us get ready for the discipline that reason requires. And to those who want to argue that, I mean, Jesus is the ultimate rabbi. There's no question about it. People call him rabbi, Jewish tradition. There's no better rabbi than Jesus. If you've studied under Jesus, you've studied under the best rabbi there is, or ever has been, ever will be. So you can hardly, you know, be disrespectful of that if you want to claim rabbinical tradition. Students of Jesus had the very best teaching of all. And so I can certainly claim that. Certainly do claim it if it's necessary to address any situations like that. The curriculum is the most challenging of all. The capability you need to employ in this curriculum is the most challenging of all. You have to be the most disciplined, the most determined, the most persistent, the most persevering. You have to forego, you know, any gratification of success for so long. Suspend judgment for so long. Let us not leap into judgment here. Let us continue to listen to the voice of reason. It's kind of like you're a judge and you're listening to these, you know, and weighing the evidence here, and you have to say, well, I have to give reason its day in court here. And then reason gives this brilliant exposition. You have to say, wow, I can't judge for, you know, the ego, because reason is given this brilliant, you know, exposition here. So I have to say to the ego, hey, I'm not going to judge yet. I'm going to have to, you know, make further determinations here. So, extremely difficult, ridiculously difficult, actually, given the situation. But, you know, that's the challenge. Can't argue with success. Really, cannot argue a success. So, we do have this very intense situation in the world. People are very much on edge now. The total tone has shifted. As I said, after starting June 22nd, the whole tone is going to shift, and indeed it has. So this is what the Holy Spirit told me to warn everyone about, that the whole tone, it's not so much what anyone says, it's the tone they say it in, meaning the attitude, the context, the contextual attitude. And the whole tone has shifted now, and it's become, as I said, the ego's given up any pretense of being our friend, you know. It's saying we're going in this direction of we're going to kill spirit, period. We're going to kill authenticity 100%, and that's the way to salvation. And they've given up any pretense to be your friend at all, friend of the other way. You know, they're saying, hey, we're going to crush that other way. They've given up any pretense. So, of course, this puts us, everyone, on edge. We're all on edge. You know, one way is obviously going towards it's annihilation, self-annihilation. Thinking that's the way. Well, sacrifice. Everyone's got to be sacrificed. We got to bring human sacrifice back. You know. And I'm going to skirt some of the more controversial statements I could make about that. Not, don't want to inflame anyone's, you know, judgment. You know, we got to keep going towards reason, suspend judgment. And again, I said the best way is to say, I'm neither responding to this or nor am I not responding to it. I neither have a position on this, nor do I not have a position on this. This is the safety net that you need to have here. And of course, a lot of people listening to this video has probably have had a very long history in Judaism in the past. Otherwise, they couldn't even follow what I'm saying, probably. Or Greco-Roman great philosophy, that, or Vedic philosophy, or Buddhist philosophy. There are other traditions that also stress this. For instance, the Vedic tradition stressed massive amount of legalism, and all disputes are gone to go to a Vedic priest, which they do then symbolic sacrificial rites, incantations, which are supposed to then resolve the situation with God so that the two parties don't have to worry about it anymore. I mean, that's also the same thing. It's the same basic thing. Is a covenant with God. They think that that what it does, it leads away from impulse to reason. Same thing with Buddhism. It leads away from impulse to reason. So all these great traditions, and same thing is with Islam too. They have all this, you know, theocracy of laws, you know, the laws of Sharia law that they go through all these. So you're not supposed to act on impulse. You're supposed to go through the law. Well, you've got a whole bunch of them, right? Some of them now that are just acting on impulse, aren't they? That's not what Islam is really about at all. That there's a system of laws where the plaintiffs come before, and then there's all sorts of levels of these laws, and gradually, you know, and we don't act on impulse. Same thing with, you know, the law that we're under, which is what Napoleonic law, pretty much. I mean, the English common law, for instance, and you know, there's laws that prevent people from acting out on impulse, right? And let's reason it out. So. There's lots of traditions. So those who are listening to these videos and trying to, you know, able to follow them to some extent, that must have had a tremendous background in minimizing your impulses and turning towards reason. Otherwise, you couldn't follow this at all. You'd immediately react in the impulsive way and say, "This guy's an idiot. What an imbecile, what a liar, impulses are the answer, you know. This is, you know, what the ego wants us to believe, that impulses are the answer. They want us to believe that our bodies are not wholly neutral. And as soon as we start saying they are, then it will say, okay, let's make a deal, I'll deal with you. Okay, you can have male bodies wholly neutral, but not the female body. The ego insists upon this. Because if you say the female body is wholly neutral, that completely exposes the whole lie, the whole scam entirely, you know. There's no more continuity to it at all. Completely exposes it. So the ego makes that its final defense, that no, the female body is not wholly neutral. It does have flesh characteristics that are intrinsic to it. And the ego defends this to the utmost, which is why we've had this massive pushback of radical feminism, which is, you know, insisting that that they're going to determine, you know, that men have no say in what the female body is really like. They stay out of it. In other words, religion, stay out of it, because they feel very threatened. The ego feels very threatened that the return of Jesus is actually, radical feminism arose right at the time of Jesus announcing that he's going to return very shortly. And the ego felt extraordinarily threatened by this. Keep in mind that Jesus started dictating A Course in Miracles. Helen Schuckman, with the transcriptions by William Tetford in the 60s. And this is when radical feminism began to arise. And then when The Course in Miracles was published and began being circulated among people in the early 70s, again, this is radical feminism became very ferocious then. And they said, the ego says, we are not going to allow this teaching, what's coming, to be applied to women, to female bodies. You can only apply it to men. You cannot apply it. We're going to decide the nature of female bodies for ourselves. You're not going to have any say in it whatsoever, Jesus. This is what they're ultimately, radical feminism, basically saying to Jesus, you are not going to have any role whatsoever in saying what the nature of the female body is at all. And of course, Jesus' whole point is to tell us all that all bodies are wholly neutral. So absolutely, Jesus has to have a role in saying what female bodies are. They're wholly neutral, as are male bodies. If you don't accept this, then you are following the Antichrist position of the ego, which tells you that first you must annihilate yourself before you can be resurrected as a new spirit. So you will follow a path of sacrifice and destruction and death and misery. Most certainly you will. And this is what the feminists are. The lipstick culture that came out of radical feminism, which is now controlling much of the politics of this world, are leading us to destruction. They most certainly are. And that's what people are very upset and agitated about right now. And which people are aware of, and what Trump is obviously saying, hey, wait a minute, you know, we don't want to be destroyed. And of course they're attacking him severely, and of course you know they would accuse him of rape. Absolutely, that's the trump card they always have, is any man that speaks out against this lipstick, you know, feminist culture, which demands that Jesus have play no role in defining what the female body is about. Anyone who speaks up in any way threatens this is automatically going to accuse them of rape, say they're a rapist. This is what they always do. And they basically, their theology is that men are inherent rapists, and all men are, if they haven't raped yet, they will at some point. Therefore, they're all guilty of rape, period. Which means, and the payment for that is they have no right to play any role in defining the nature of the female body at all. So men have to completely stay out of it. That's why men now are just feel like, you know, they're completely emasculated. The women are saying, you have no role to play whatsoever. But this is not true, because the role of spirit, which is what we really are, is to say that all bodies are wholly neutral. Not just male bodies, but all bodies, period. All nature, entire universe is wholly neutral. That we are just dreaming. This is a pretense. We're projecting all needs. We're projecting upon these bodies. The need to die is completely projected by. The need to have children, to reproduce, is complete projection upon the body. All of this is a projection upon the body. This is very central to what Jesus has to say. If you don't accept this, you're going to go into Christological debates of two different natures, two different wills, which we've been done for the last 2,000 years, so we've just been repeating ourselves ad absurdum, you know. It's ridiculous. So feminism is just, radical feminism is just pushing us back into absurdity. Let's just repeat the last 2,000 years over again as if they never happened. This is idiocy. This is extreme folly. So this is why everybody's on edge. You know, we're getting down to it, aren't we? Because Jesus is here. He's already returned. Turn May 1st, and this people on edge now. They're saying, well, we got to decide. Wait a minute. Are we going to go along with a self-destructive philosophy? That first we have to, in order to be happy, we first have to annihilate ourselves to satisfy guilt. And only then can we be resurrected from our annihilation to be a new spirit. You know, is that true? Is that the truth? Or is that the lie, you see? That, and I say, that's the lie. That's absolutely the lie. And Docetus say, of course, that Jesus never was born in the first place. So they never suffered. It was never crucified. It was all a play of appearancing. It was just appearance. It was a pretense. All pretending. And this is accurate. It was all pretense. Jesus is pointing out to us, it's all pretense. He said, but you won't understand this unless I point it out to you very clearly and challenge you. You know, so he challenged us very severely. So, as long as you believe in victimization, when you say that the bodies are wholly neutral, you say there's no victimization. We're just acting out, pretending to be dead. Period. So all, without any exception. So Jesus, in the Course in Miracles, he emphasizes there is no exception to truth whatsoever. And you cannot be saved until you accept this fact. You cannot. Otherwise, then you will be subject to all this guilt and all these tactics that the ego uses. So we have to say there is no exception whatsoever. And the feminists are insisting you cannot define our experiencing force whatsoever. We will decide, meaning the ego will decide. And we say, no, we're not accepting that God will decide. And the will of God, there's only one will. And therefore, there isn't any debate whatsoever about the truth. There's no such thing as victimization. The body is wholly neutral. There's no exception to this whatsoever. Never has been, never will be. So there's no debate at all. There's only one nature. We're pretending to be dead, to try and gain proof that we're greater than God. That's all that's going on here, nothing else. So truth does speak for all here. There's not separate truths for men and women at all, for male body, female body. There's not separate truths for that whatsoever. So the whole feminism, radical feminism, is a scam. True feminism, I support, which is to say women can get to reason too. Absolutely they can, and they should. which means set aside impulse, including all the feminine impulses, including all the psychic impulses that females are very adept at. They dominate the psychic realm and dominate men there, absolutely, and use that to dominate men. They have to set aside those psychic impulses too to get to reason. Reason is not some psychic condition at all. It's beyond that, transcends that. So I absolutely support women setting aside their impulses. Stop claiming that there's some feminine impulses that they have to follow. You know, that was the original thought. And say, hey, wait a minute, you know. The women, female bodies are wholly neutral too, absolutely. But radical feminism, which was the backlash to feminism. See, the backlash to feminism is radical feminism. That is the egoic backlash to it. And this is what is controlling the political politics of the world right now, actually, to an extreme extent. Some people call it the sorority sisters, you know, are just dominating. And they are. There's no question about it. So, again, I'm absolutely for feminism, totally against radical feminism. Radical feminism is the egoic backlash to feminism, okay, plain and simple. And so I 100% support that spirit who is identifying with the female body. They have absolutely have the right to say this female body is wholly neutral, absolutely, and so is the male body, wholly neutral. There are no such thing as natural impulses whatsoever. This is all 100% projected upon the body. I can use reason to see what you know, to see the folly, to repent. I can use reason to truly repent and truly be saved. I'm 100% for that. Always have been, always will be. Okay, so there's no confusion in this whatsoever. But I'm not going to be, you know, pushed around or bullied at all by radical feminism, as it tries to insist that it's the true feminism. It is not. It's the false feminism. Absolutely false. Radical feminism is the false feminism of the ego, trying to usurp, trying to say, oh, no, wait a minute, we've got to have two natures here. Can't let any men are the enemy. You can't let them tell you anything about whether they tell you the truth or not. Doesn't matter. They can't tell you that, you know. So let's fight that fight first, you know. So they diverted feminism to a war on men, essentially. And, of course, typical of radical feminism is whatever they're doing, they insist that, no, it's the other side that's doing it. So they're saying, oh, there's this terrible war against women, war against women. No, there isn't. It's a war against men is what's happening. It's a war of saying that men have no right to say anything at all in regard to females. So men cannot confess the truth because the truth is for all. And they're saying, no, any confession that men make for women is completely inherently invalid, which is nonsense, which is basically saying that Jesus can't say anything. That's what they're really saying. So it's really a war against Jesus that the radical feminists have been promulgating from the get-go. And I was very aware of it from the very get-go. I was aware when it shifted, when the backlash arose, where women were doing very good work, actually, and working very much towards accepting Jesus' return. The radical feminism tried to co-opt all this and towards actually trying to prevent Jesus from returning, or when he did return, to insist that nobody listened to anything he had to say, and that if men listened to what he had to say, they couldn't say anything anyway because they're not allowed to say anything about women, and any public profession automatically can be construed as being for both men and women, therefore men can't say anything at all. This is the ultimate end game of radical feminism, is that men can't say anything. They can't say anything. They have to be just completely quiet and say nothing. And their quietism has to be submission to women, not quietism in the presence of Jesus. So you neither can you say anything, and your quietism has to be a groveling submission, fearful submission to women. That's what radical feminism is after, and they're controlling the politics of the day. And Trump doesn't play that game, and that's why they're out to absolutely destroy him. Not that Trump is... He just has selfish interests. He wants to protect, you know. He's a businessman, okay? He's not any some religious scholar or wisdom person, you know, at all. But yet he still is interfering with the plans of radical feminism. And so you can see how absolutely vicious they are. How absolutely vicious they are. They want men to be, have no say whatsoever and to be absolutely silent. In other words, they want to completely undercut Jesus. So Jesus has no one to no one to hang out with and joke with and help them out. They want to cut off any help for Jesus whatsoever in the hope that he can then say, well, there's nobody here. I can't do anything, so I'm going to leave or not even come back. You know, that's their goal. Their goal is to prevent Jesus from coming back in the first place. They failed at that. Their goal is to prevent anyone from speaking in concert with Jesus. Well, I'm speaking in concert with Jesus. They failed at that. So there's two extreme failures that they already have. See, so don't put your stock in radical feminism because it's already severely failed. But by all means, if you're a male, if you're a female, speak up and say, yeah, all bodies are wholly neutral. There's no such thing as impulses and bodies. Everything is a play of spirit. There's no such thing as victimization. Never has been. Now, I remember a Jewish woman speaking up in the 70s saying that she did cause her own rape. She absolutely planned the whole thing, and she realized now, she said, in the light of reason, I see the whole thing was a setup, and there was no victimization, but I was trying to make it seem like it was. And she said, wow, it's all this way. And then she said, oh my God, I'm going to be crucified by my sisters. They're going to absolutely crucify me. And she said, well, I don't know what to do here. So, you see, there are some Jewish women who are actually very smart and very clear about it, and yet a lot of them have gone into radical feminism and said, you know what, if we go into this, we're going to gain total control and total power, and we can satisfy the vanities of the flesh to the ultimate extent. So why not do that, you know? And so there was this big war among Jewish women, actually, in the 70s, of which direction to go in. And keep in mind, Helen Schuckman was a Jewish woman who agreed to bring forth A Course in Miracles, agreed to help out Jesus, as were a lot of the people in A Course in Miracles were actually Jewish. They decided they're going to help Jesus, you know, and then there was a backlash about that. Some Jewish women tried to hijack A Course in Miracles and twist it into radical feminism and say that men's job is to be subservient to women and satisfy and pleasure them and satisfy whatever the vanities of flesh they have. They tried to, you know, twist it that way. Jesus told me, just don't pay attention to that. Don't worry about it. He says you'll get it eventually. Don't be bothered by that. That's what the Holy Spirit told me. Don't be bothered. He said, yeah, I know. I know what's going on. Don't worry about it. So I said, okay. I just kept plodding along. But now we see what's going on. The apocalypse is here. We see what's going on. Now we can speak. I had to hold my speech for, you know, 40 years, almost 40 years. I couldn't say anything. I just saw, I said, this is wrong. This is, you know, hey, wait a minute. You know, call a foul here. But now the Holy Spirit said, hey, you know, when the apocalypse comes, you'll be able to speak up, but not now. Because I could have been intimidated, severely intimidated, of course. You know, they're going to say, they say that the God is going to intercede with God, seduce God, which is completely sexist, of course. The idea that God is some male figure that can't help but be seduced by a female figure, which is, you know, sexism, stereotyping males as being inherently, which again projects an inherent quality onto the flesh, doesn't it? That the flesh isn't neutral, that the flesh has these impulses and they can't resist these impulses, which is saying God is a body, essentially, isn't it? Which is totally arrogant. So I say, go ahead. Yeah, go ahead and influence God. Do it right now. Because I'm not going to wait for you. I'm not going to wait for you, that's for sure. So, this here channel is part of the apocalypse. Apocalyptic comedy club, you know, apocalyptic cafe, apocalyptic satsang, apocalyptic contemplation, apocalyptic exposition, awareness, whatever, you know, you can say all this stuff and more, and all of it's true. And you're getting it here, you're getting it, you know, in strong doses right now, actually. We're not pulling so many punches anymore, are we? Because it's on, it's absolutely on. Like I said, the Holy Spirit told me, June 22nd, it's on, full on. It's the apocalypse, it's full on right now. You're going to have a year of this intense apocalypse, and then it's probably tribulation is going to be full scale on after that. If not tribulation, even sooner. I mean, there may be some overlapping of it. There may be some overlapping of it. If an asteroid does hit, you know, that's an overlapping of the apocalypse and the tribulation period, etc. I hope none of that happens, absolutely. I want people, I don't want them acting on impulse. I want them acting on reason. Or not acting. I want them to allow reason to illuminate their minds and say, there's nothing I need to do. There's nothing I need to reconcile. There's no two wills. There's no two natures. this is all a pretense. All I need to do is then to shift pretending that I'm dead to pretending that I'm eternal life. And that's it. That's it. That's all I need to do. And the Holy Spirit does that for me. So I can just sit back and enjoy. So we sit back and enjoy the apocalypse too, actually. But we're bringing this all to light now. That's what I'm doing. I'm helping Jesus. I said I would. I promised I would. And Jesus said, well, I don't know. We'll see. We'll see. It's not easy, is it? No, it's not easy, that's for sure. And hopefully this is helping a lot of people out. Some people, too, you know, really, that need the help because they're under a lot of pressure. They're thinking, how in the world can I help out? You know, I want to help, but my gosh, I'm going to be crushed. You know, but by hearing this, you say, well, wait a minute, you know. Maybe not. Not so fast. Maybe there is a way to stand up to all this, you know, and not be crushed. This is what I'm feeling. Like, maybe I can say this, you know. Whereas before, you know, you think that's crazy. You know, you say this, you're going to be absolutely crushed, you know. Well, I'm saying not so fast, you know. Go ahead and crush God if you can, and then get back to me, you know. Or if you want to crush God, go ahead. God and I are the same, so we're all one, so go ahead. Don't waste my time. I'm not interested in you threatening me. Go threaten God. You know, ultimately, that's the bluff. You know, the ego's bluffing. So call the ego's bluff. Say, well, their ultimate bluff will send the goddess to God and telling you the goddess has ways to change God's mind. Well, go ahead and do it then, this very instant. And I accept the full judgment of God upon me this very instant, or any instant, okay? The full. No punches pulled. Full punishment, full judgment, whatever the judgment is. Maybe the judgment is punishment, maybe the judgment is perfection, eternal life. Whatever the judgment is, you know, go ahead and do it. Send the goddess to God right away. And, you know, the ego, the calls the ego's bluff. At that point, there's nothing else the ego can say. Because everything is actually based on trying to make a deal, scaring us into making a deal. We don't have to make a deal with the ego, you see? So all these threatening lawyers and threatening radical feminists and all these, this whole massive machinery of threat that they're trying to scare everybody with, I just say, you know, wait, that's nothing to me. You go send the goddess to God, and if she can't work out, change God's will, then you're finished. That's it. That's the bottom line. It's all a lie. It's all a pretense. There's nothing they can say to that, really, you know, spiritually. That's it. Most people, though, are too scared to do that. They think the goddess, you know, there is two natures, that somehow the female body is not wholly neutral, and therefore it has some other will, and therefore it has some other will. It must have some influence on God. It has to have, right, if there's some separate will. So as long as they believe that, the ego will be able to threaten them and bluff them, you know, right? But if you're hearing this, you say, hey, wait a minute, you know, maybe it's true. What's being said here is true. And then this will enable you to breathe a little easier, sleep a little easier, and you say, wow, wait a minute, you know. Not so fast, ego. Not so fast. I'm not going to leap into any deal with you. Not so fast here. So those who help with Jesus are helping out, say, hey, not so fast. Don't panic, everyone. Maybe Jesus isn't so whipped as the radical feminists want you to think that he is. And of course, the radical feminists are handing out candy, eye candy as fast as possible, pornography. They've been absolutely supportive of that in many ways. In many, many ways, actually. And I found that out, too, in a dream recently. That they say, hey, boys, you know, as much sex as you want. You know, all the eye candy, all the indulgence you want. Just don't, you know, bother us, you know. So they try to buy off the boys as much as possible. Absolutely, in any way possible. So all the pornography merchants, they put up with that. Absolutely put up with it. In fact, they actually subtly encourage it. It's amazing how hypocritical they are. You know, Trump pointed out that 80% of the Hispanic women, Latino women that are coming through Mexico get raped on their way here. You didn't hear a peep out of the radical feminists, did you? No, they ended up just accusing Trump of being a rapist. That was their response. You know, so they're absolutely hypocritical. They absolutely support and behind the pornography to try to buy men off, right? Say, hey guys, don't worry, you know. that, you know, women do have these women's body is not wholly neutral. It's impulsive. There's the flesh nature, but we'll give you the best of that flesh nature. You can indulge in that. We'll show you how great that is. Just don't assert. You know, just don't support Jesus. As long as you don't support Jesus, you're okay with us. So we'll do whatever you ask, as long as you don't support Jesus. And they tried to bribe me. They absolutely tried to bribe me to the utmost. I'm speaking from experience here. Oh, sure, whatever you want. Whatever you want. Mansion in Hawaii, play golf all the time, a harem of beautiful women, drugs, parties, you name it. Whatever you want, you can have it. Of course, they were just saying that, you know. Just to make me think, like, you know, so look, consider me, how do I get that? You know, so, well, you know, just keep supporting us and you'll get that. You know, the whole purpose is don't support Jesus. That's their whole purpose. So keep in mind of the timing that's been going on. You know, radical feminism is very different than feminism, actually. It's a completely different, totally different, actually. At cross purposes do it, actually. This is why a lot of women are confused. I say, I don't know what the heck's going on here. This is really confusing. So hopefully this is helping undo that confusion. And of course, the fear, like, well, if I don't use all the psychic, you know, capabilities I have to control men and get what I want, how am I going to have all the lust of the vanities of the flesh satisfied? Well, you're not. But you're going to realize there aren't any vanities of the flesh at all. There's only the bliss, the peace, the glory of God that spirit has as its intrinsic nature. So you will have all of that, and you realize that you're perfect. You'll have the pretending that you are eternal life. Spider hanging out, day spider in the daytime now, and not in the night. And there's a night spider here, so. So forget about the vanities of the flesh. Forget about trying to hold on to the psychic as if that was some important level or something. It's not. But this is something I can say because I was aware of this. I spent years examining, just observing men and women. Then I realized that women are operating in a different way. They're operating in a psychic way. And they use this to control men. They're like a half step ahead of men, so to speak. But they're not. It's not really. It's just two different sideshows that are going on, actually. And so they try to control men. They try to steer men, guide men, make men think that men are deciding on their own. And the women says, "Wow, you got me what I wanted. How did you do that? You're really smart." But really, the women are subtly maneuvering them and putting ideas into their minds. And the men think that they're, you know, geniuses or something. This is what's happening. This is what's been going on from time immemorial. You have to give that up. You have to understand that men who realize that the bodies are wholly neutral, they're not going to be fooled by that. You can't manipulate them that way. You know, so you have to give up. That has to be given up. Absolutely. Can't play all those silly games. You have to really get to the wow of it, you know, of your eternal nature. That no bodies have any intrinsic leanings one way or the other. Complete, wholly neutral. Completely neutral, as Jesus put it. Very important. There can be no exception to this. And stay away from impulsive stuff. The culture is totally impulsive right now. This is the whole radical feminism, the lipstick culture and the pajama boys and the ego and all of that are promoting cosmic corporate culture, promoting impulsiveness, 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 impulsiveness. And then trying to get people to act on impulse and then blackmailing them for doing so. And, you know, it goes on and on. It's the nastiest of nastiest situations now in the world. Everybody's on edge. They're trying to figure out, which, how do I vote? How do I vote? Elections tomorrow. You know, how do I vote? And like, so they're very snappy. I've been noticing that. I've been trying to be very expansive and optimistic to people. And they're very like, huh? Like, what's the matter with you? You know, because I've already decided which way to vote. I know. So I'm not bothered by this now. I'm very optimistic. I'm feeling very expansive. Whereas those who can't figure out which way to vote, you know, which way is my happiness? They're like really stressed out right now. Saying, shut up, I don't want to hear anything from you. You know, that's why nobody's watching these videos hardly. It's just like, I can't decide, you know, I can't decide which way to go. Eventually, once they decide, I think a lot more people will pay attention. But right now, there's not so much attention because they're really freaking out about. I can't. Which way is it? Which way is it? I'm not sure. There's so much propaganda from the ego going on. The arrogance. The ego is just our arrogance, believing that we can have our cake and eat it too. We can destroy God and yet survive that somehow. Bad news, good news. The bad news is if we destroyed God, we couldn't survive it. The good news is we can't destroy God, so we don't have to worry about it. So the good news trumps the bad news. Good news trumps the bad news. So in terms of lawyers, I might say I have the best lawyer of all, Jesus. Holy Spirit, you know, God, Holy Spirit lawyer, Jesus lawyer. Wow. Mail delivery. And we said, we can't say that. Person delivery. Mail, it sounds too much like mail, you know. Have to change the wording there. Correspondence delivery person. Package delivery person. Correspondence delivery person. Here is a correspondence delivery person. Now, part of, we can go on and on and on and on and on, but let's keep the focus tighter here. Which is the wow of it. Because this is of course apocalyptic content here. So the first image of Jesus, this beautiful graphic, artistic graphic that I've had the privilege to participate in producing with along with the Holy Spirit, was clarity. The text said clarity. The second just said wow, right? And the third said apocalypse. Apocalypse. Wow. I was up to 1:30 last night just about doing this. Apocalypse. Showed Jesus in an apocalyptic setting, you know. So these three: clarity, wow, apocalypse. Those are the three. I believe that's what I did. Did I do another one? Or did I do? This morning I did one, didn't I? I haven't put it up everywhere though yet. Oh, actually, I haven't shown it yet to you, have I? Yes, I have. Journey Beyond Words, right? So the next one is, okay. Our journey is Journey Beyond Words. I guess this is day four. Of doing this. Journey Beyond Words, there you go. So we've got the clarity, the wow, the apocalypse. Now there's a Journey Beyond Words, where words really don't describe it. A lot of the problems with the Christology debates was that words don't describe it. How can words describe what is in has no definition? So people just were tearing their hair out trying to nuance all these words, you know, and say, well, maybe I have a slight variation here. No, that's anathema. Well, here's another slight variation. Well, that's anathema too. And it's all an anathema, ultimately, because you can't really describe truth at all. And so wow is a better way to put it. You know, the word just wow. And then from wow, we go, you know, Journey Beyond Words, as we are experiencing the apocalypse here. Lifting of the veil on the whole city, how the nastiness. So I said, wow. It's kind of like they're talking about the earthquake and tsunami in Crete in 365, where Alexandria was wiped out pretty much. A lot of cities were wiped out, decimated. The earthquake decimated a lot of the that world at that time, and then the tsunami hit Alexandria so strong, and you know it was a massive tsunami. And the Greek historian wrote about it. It's an eyewitness apparently of seeing this, and he said, you know, there was just a massive earthquake, and then the ocean just disappeared, just withdrew from the shore and left all the sea creatures exposed. And he said they're flopping, all these sea creatures. He's like, oh my gosh, just like he said, it's bizarre. And there's all these people that went in and started picking up all the fish and all the sea creatures, you know, to collect them, to eat them. And then the ocean came roaring back, as we know, a tsunami happens, and just, you know, inundated everything, threw ships miles inland. You know, it's devastating. Just as we saw in the Fukushima, Wakamatsu, that area of Japan, you know, Fukushima area, right? Yeah, Fukushima. comes roaring in. It's extraordinary. Well, that happened in Crete, because the earthquake was like a, you know, right up there with, you know, above 8, could be close up to 8.5, 9. You know, it's huge, and certainly caused devastation. Wow, that's a big wow. So they tried to, you know, they tried to figure out that one. You know, how come? Why does that happen? You know, why does that happen? So anyway, it was like an apocalypse because the ocean subsided, and you saw all these fish there. And the Roman writers are just like, wow, it's a mind blower. He says, wow, that's like an apocalypse unveiling. So right now it's like a tsunami. We're having huge earthquake, and the ocean is receding, and we're having this apocalypse. We're saying, oh my God, you know, everything was being unmasked. You know, but it's all being done gently and kindly with respect here, and this is for everyone's benefit. You know, it's not like I'm attacking anyone really. I'm unmasking them, but not attacking them. I'm just saying, you know, in the eyes of God, we're all perfectly equal. We're all perfect. God's not paid any attention to any of the stupidity that we've been engaged with, you know, none. So from the standpoint of God, there's no judgment upon anyone. So I'm not judging anyone. I'm not saying I'm some surrogate judge. I'm judging these people. No, I don't know. There's no judgment. It's just simply unmasking and seeing what's going on. Oh, okay, this is what the radical feminists are really about. Now we know. We knew all along, it's just we couldn't say it up till this point for some, you know, we were just too intimidated by it, really. And too, you know, induced by all the, you know, inducements that they've been giving us. You know, free love, guys. Just turn away from Jesus, that's all you got to do. Great impulsive music. So yeah, well, they have free love. It's not that great. Oh, well, you can listen to this impulsive music. Oh, okay, that makes me more impulsive. And so you don't know how to experience the true fleshy nature of women. You see, that you just don't know about. There's mysteries there to uncover. Really? Oh yeah. I mean, you guys don't have your bodies are wholly neutral. You can say that, but our bodies, no, we have this separate will, fleshy will, and there's unlimited glories and mysteries of there, and you can never get enough of it. And the guys, and so this impulsive music will help you. And the guy said, well, you know, I'm kind of bored about that. I said, okay, well, there's drugs, all these drugs. That'll really help explore the mysteries of the female body, you know, and then. Guys say, well, yeah, but there's still the same old, you know, nagging, and this is not really that great. You know, same old insecurities, you know, same old. No. You just mix the drugs and the sex and the rock and roll, impulsive music, and then the fear and you know, and all this. Let's mix them together. And come on, you need to keep exploring. You know, the mysteries of the female body are so amazing. You know, the bid said, oh, actually, it's kind of getting tired and repulsive. How dare you, you know, now we're going to put you under threat, you know. So when that inducements don't work, and all the pornography, you know, they say, well, look, there's so much different bodies to explore, you know, millions and hundreds of millions. It's just you never can get tired of it. And they say, oh, you know, God, you know, same old, look at the corpses, rotting corpses, really, and the same old whiny insecurities and dominating ways and psychic trickery, and it's all the same stuff. I mean, come on, right? You know, it doesn't sound like this really is really much of a deal at all. Well, just don't say anything bad about it, and we'll set you up in Hawaii, you know, with the lovely native girls, and then you can just hang out and, you know, enjoy life. And, oh, really? How are you going to do that? Well, you know, it's going to happen. Don't worry. Well, I don't see it happening. Well, you got to help out, make it happen. Well, I really can't make it happen. Well, that's your fault. You know, well, just don't worry. It'll happen for you. We'll arrange it somehow. You know, so, well, maybe you're lying about all this. You know, what? How dare you? You know, and so they've just been trying to, you know, delay. It's a delaying game, and gradually figure it out. The goddess is just playing a delaying game. It's all bluff, all false promises. So we're just bringing this to light, saying, hey, that way doesn't work. You don't make illusions true and then escape from them. You know, that's what Jesus tells you. You can't make illusions true and escape from them. The idea of the death of spirit is an illusion. We can't make that illusion true and then escape from it. This is what Jesus is telling us in the Course in Miracles. Listen to the great rabbi Jesus. Absolutely. I use the term Jesus. That's the Hellenized version. Okay, I'm not going Hebrew and saying Yeshua. I mean, Hellenization of Yeshua is what Jason, Joseph, Jesus, you know, very ways of Hellenizing Hebrew terms. But Hebrew terms are for the period of the law. Okay, but so I just use the term Jesus. I know a lot of people, of Course in Miracles, want to say Yeshua. You know, this is Yeshua. You know, maybe it makes them feel more, you know, Jewish if they do that. But I don't have feeling a need for that. The ends are not the means. I mean, the means are not the end. The means are not the end at all. Okay, so I'm speaking a lot to the Gentiles, to the Hellenized Jews, because I don't use the term Jesus, and that's fine. I'm fine with that. Hot today. Very hot. It's totally still. 100 degrees. It's supposed to be 100 again today. It's probably right now. I don't know what it is, but it's probably close to, you know, maybe 90, 97, 98 climbing. But we're out here taping away, being part of the apocalypse. Be part of the positiveness of the apocalypse, and don't get down there in the ocean once the waters have receded. Oh, I gotta collect all these fish. I gotta collect all these fish. No. When you see the high, flee to higher ground. Go to higher ground. So I say, don't get wrapped up in all the stuff that's happening, the viciousness, you know. Recognize it and say, oh, wow. Those sorority sisters really are vicious, aren't they? Wow. Okay. But that's it. You know, just go to higher ground. Okay, what's the truth? Okay, let me hang out with Jesus then. Again, they'd much rather have you attacking them than hanging out with Jesus. That their whole point is, attack us, attack us, attack us. And then that distracts you from Jesus. All we're doing here is gently, lovingly, intelligently, reasonably bringing it all to light and saying, okay, then now, all right. Just let it be, let it be. Don't go collecting the fish once the tsunami waters receded, because they're going to come roaring back in very soon. So if you don't know how to hang out with Jesus, the tribulation is going to be nasty here. As those believe that in order to be saved, we have to annihilate ourselves. First, we have to make illusions true. We have to die and then be resurrected from that death. You know, isn't that what we told Jesus? Jesus, you know, who's to say, may have come here and said, okay, you know, I'm going to show you what you believe. Okay, and then we're going to work on that. Make it clear to you, this is apocalypse, beginning of the apocalypse. You believe that first spirit must die, and then it must be reborn and resurrected. So you insist that I be crucified on a cross, and then you insist that I could be resurrected from that death. Okay, that is very well may what took place, actually. See, the ego's, our goal, the spirit's goal, try to be greater than God, is to insist that spirit must die in order to prove that God indeed also died. And then from that death, be resurrected back as new spirit, which is now greater than God. So the whole story about Jesus follows this very closely, doesn't it? So either that story was made up, or Jesus played along with it, showing them to reveal to them, to the world, this is what you're trying to do. Okay? That very well may be the case, right? He said, you know, I'm just going along with this. This is what your God wants. Guilt, God of guilt, this is what your God wants. And then they were shocked, you know, wow. I mean, Jesus is so wonderful. And then we killed him. And then he was resurrected, but we're stunned by this whole thing. You know, how's this possible? You know. So and then the final part of it, we leave out the final part, which is he left the world for the kingdom of heaven. He said, this world is not my kingdom. See, they thought once he's resurrected, now he's back to rule over the kingdom here as the new kingdom, usher in the new millennium. We say, okay, we succeeded. We died. It means to prove that God died, and now we're resurrected, we're new spirit, and now the millennium should happen. Instead of the millennium happening, Jesus left and said, oh, I'm not staying here. This place is the Prince of Darkness's domain. I'm going to the kingdom of heaven. They said, what? We don't get it. You don't get what? So that was a stunner. You know, it stunned them. So they're scratching their heads. So really, the leaving of Jesus is the most significant part of it all. The ascension is the most, you know, significant part of it all. So wait a minute, why did you go through all that stuff if you're not just going to leave? That doesn't make any sense. See, it doesn't make any sense at all, does it? So that's what they need to look at. Say, maybe Jesus was just showing us what we think is salvation. And then he's saying, no, it's not, you don't get it, it's not. This doesn't deliver you a kingdom at all. See, they thought Jesus would set up a perfect millennial kingdom here for him. He didn't. So this is the stunner. And so they had to try to rationalize this in their minds, you know, to figure out, you know, what the heck's going on. How do we get him to come back and be king over this, you know, start the millennial kingdom? There isn't any millennial kingdom. You know, the kingdom that we inherit is the pretending to be eternal life. But in that instance, it's a place that's always seemed to be this way. There's no evidence of death at all. Or impermanence at all. That's the death-free realm. So that they said, where are you going? He said, I'm going to prepare a place for you. I'm come back and take you there. What? You know, what? That's the important part. When Jesus left, just before he left, where are you going? Okay, this is the truth. Let me tell you. There are many rooms in my Father's mansion. If it weren't so, I would have told you. Here's the insect on making that noise, right? Cicada or something. It's kicking up a fuss, saying it's getting hot. You know? I gotta cool myself down. Maybe the cicada does that to cool itself down. You know, isn't that a possibility? Something like that. Maybe that vibration causes air circulation or something. It's a body heating their, you know, cooling the body heat down. Might be something like that. I think all animals have some way of it. Like dogs, they pant, you know, it gets hot, they evaporate from their tongue, they try to, you know, evaporate the heat, you know, that way. Cats are just really smart. They find an air-conditioned house. They find some cool place somewhere. They always manage to find some place that's cool enough, I guess. They can pant a little bit too if they get too hot, but they don't do anything when it's hot. Whereas dogs are still running around. They just the pant, you're so hot. Oh, God. Cats, they disappear. Usually it's in the air-conditioned house. Cats are very psychic, actually. So are dogs. But yeah. Nature runs on psychicness a lot of it, actually. Human males actually were, you know, pressured into doing a whole bunch of real heavy labor, slave labor and stuff, and they were told that they can't use the psychic abilities. You know, they were told that they might say, hey, wait a minute, you know, I don't really need to do this and stuff, and I can't be enslaved so easily. So they were, you know, they took on the notion that they're just like animals, brute animals, have to just keep work, like, you know, so they don't think they have the psychic dimension to them so much, but they certainly do. But we're not concerned with that. This transcends all of that nonsense. You know, how if we configure this pretending to be dead. You know, we don't have to go over all that stuff. It doesn't work. The bottom line, it's all, you know, it's like saying which number is more like zero. What are all the numbers that I've thrown up against zero? You know, it doesn't matter what number we've thrown up against zero. It's still zero. Zero times whatever is zero. So we don't have to go back through all the secret doctrines of all the different machinations that we've used to all the pretenses and how we structured all the pretense. Doesn't matter. None of it matters. Don't need the pretense. We exchange all pretense that we've ever done for the pretense of eternal life. That's all we need to do. Plain and simple. That's all that Jesus tells us. Just the entirety of all the pretense that you've used doesn't matter. Turn it all over to the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit will exchange it for one pretense, which is the pretense of eternal life. That's it. We don't have to read the secret doctrine, Isis Unveiled, and all that kind of stuff, which talks about all how we've imagined ourselves into fleshy bodies and all this kind of stuff. You know, none of that matters. It's all pretense anyway. It's all completely useless. We have no need for it whatsoever. We can't change the will of God at all. Therefore, this pretending to be dead, it goes absolutely nowhere. Trying to prove that we succeeded, we did not succeed. We can never succeed. This is much ado about nothing. Existence is much ado about nothing. So, exchange all the machinations, the Machiavellianness, the permutations, combinations, strategies, plans, everything we've done, which are just ad absurdum. They're so complex and almost infinite, you know, efforts. Exchange all of that in one lump sum package for the pretense of pretending to be eternal life, which the Holy Spirit is a judgment of the Holy Spirit upon time for us. Just exchange that. The Holy Spirit will make the exchange, just, you know, absolutely will. This is my belief. I keep aiming for that. Very simple, isn't it? Jesus is not bringing about complexity, esoteric complexity at all. He says, no, drop all that. It's not necessary. None of it is necessary. As Buddha said, that the real wise ones are already on the other side. He said, how do you cross this river? He said, the real wise ones are already on the other side. So there's no question of how do we cross it. We're already across it. See, this is similar, right? You just exchange all the complexity for the simplicity of vision, pretending vision of eternal life. That's it. There's no how did we get here. We got here by making the exchange. Holy Spirit made a deal with the Holy Spirit. The only deal there is, exchange one bundle of pretense for the one pretense of exchange the pretense that we're dead for the pretense that we're eternal life. And the pretense of trying to pretend to be dead is extremely complex and convoluted and jumbled. And whereas the pretense of eternal life is absolutely elegant and simple and graceful and beautiful, lovely, amazing. How are we doing? Pretty good here, right? So people are very whacked out right now, and they say they're under pressure to decide, and they know there's one way is the wrong way, one way is the right way, but they can't really determine which is which. This puts them under hellish pressure, doesn't it? When you talk about burnout, this is what causes burnout, is we know we have to make a decision, and we know one direction is definitely really, really wrong, and it's going to cause me horrible suffering, and yet I say I can't quite figure out which way to go, you know, so that is just causes, you know, horrible burnout in the mind and the body. Terrible. So hopefully by listening to these videos, you start to say, hey, I think I'm getting a better sense of this. You know, I don't need to freak out so bad. Let me relax a little bit. Let me just say maybe yes, maybe no to everything. And when I do that, the right way is inherently will seem more attractive to me, inherently. So the real secret is to say, well, maybe I'm deciding, maybe I'm not deciding. Maybe I have a reply, maybe I don't have a reply. Maybe I have a response, maybe I don't have a response. Maybe I'm responding, maybe I'm not responding. And you'll feel this takes all the pressure off of you. Okay, a lot. Just try this. I mean, just try it for myself. I just immediately relaxed. It's like, wow, it's fantastic. It's like a miracle practice. It is a miracle practice. So by doing this and going into no judgment, the truth, which is already true within us, will automatically, the attractiveness will dawn upon us. We'll become more and more aware of it. And then we'll say, oh, that's easy. I see it. That's the right way. And then the wrong way will become more and more clear. Oh, that's not the wrong, that's the wrong way. So what the practice for it is, don't go directly, trying to directly discern too much. Practice the neutral way, because the ego is saying, well, how about this? I both don't have a response for you, and I also have a response. Or I neither have a response, nor do I not have a response. See that? I neither have a response, nor do I not have a response. So try to look at it that way. I neither have a response, nor I neither am making a response, nor am I not making a response. I'm neither responding, nor am I not responding. I'm neither responding nor not responding. And this is like some sort of, you know, refuge. Great summer day. I'm feeling it right now. Lovely summer day. I'm neither responding, nor am I not responding. Summer wind right now came blowing in across the sea. Yeah, so there's a little summer wind coming in now. And you know, so what's next? Autumn. And they say, I lost you to the summer wind. Well, we know that autumn is coming, so we better get right the apocalyptic wave, you know. Don't let it inundate us, ride it. So, this is probably enough for this one. I could go on, but it's already quite extensive and been super intense, of course. And I'll get with, you know, doing more. I don't have any work today. It's very unfortunate. Absolutely zero work. This is a big issue, but just trust in the Holy Spirit. Glass is half full. And full stop in the wow. Practice it right now. Just, I'm neither for or against anything right now. I'm neither for or against anything right now. Practice that. See, once you've heard all this, go into full stop in the wow. You have full permission. I get full permission to do that. I advocate it. I don't want you to say, oh, you're so wonderful. This is a great video. Oh, my gosh. No. I don't want that. Go full stop into the wow right now. Once you've heard it, say, I'm not for anything or against anything right now. I'm neither responding nor not responding. And then leave the talk in that way. Okay, so if you want to know how do you leave the talk, full stop in the wow is how you leave the talk. You arrive silently, you leave silently, you're silent in between. But most of all, you arrive in the mood of repentance, you remain in the mood of repentance, and you leave in the wow, leave in full stop in the wow mode. Okay, so don't worry about, you can handle it, you can handle it. I assume if I met Jesus, the same thing. I might arrive with a joke or two. Arrive with humor, remain in humor, leave with humor, but ultimately leave in full stop in the wow. Say, I'm neither agreeing nor disagreeing. Okay, I'm neither agreeing nor disagreeing. I'm neither agreeing nor disagreeing. I'm neither responding nor am I not responding. I'm in neutral mode, full stop in the wow mode. And this will definitely put you in a different attitude, okay? It's not an anxiety attitude when you do this. It's something different. And you might say, well, the anxiety is going to clobber me when I come out of this. Well, who's to say that's really true? Isn't that just a threat of the ego? Saying, come out of this right now and I'll go easy on you? Don't believe in the threats of the ego. Go say, hey, go ahead, clobber me right now. See, the ego's threatening, hey, when you come out of this, wow, I'm going to clobber you with anxiety. Just say, hey, if you can clobber me with anxiety, do it right now or shut up. Because I deserve it. I'm a child of truth. I deserve truth right now. So if the truth is I'm going to be clobbered with anxiety, clobber me right now. Is this stopped or what? Doing stuff. Clobber me right now. And if you can't clobber right now, then you must be a liar. So I don't believe it's going to be worse. So you stand up to the ego that way. So stay in a full stop on the wow. Say, no, I'm going to just stay here. And what happens is you start getting more and more confidence over the ego, and your anxiety will greatly lessen. Anytime the ego tries to threaten me, I just go full stop on the wow. Hey, I'm neither responding to you, ego, nor am I not responding to you. And don't judge for what you just heard. Don't judge against it. When you go full stop, don't judge for or against it. And then that prevents the ego from threatening you and bluffing you and pulling you back into conceptualization and struggle and fear and all that. So just stay in full stop in the wow mode. No impulses. I'm neither acting on impulses, nor am I not acting on them. See, just don't let the ego get a handle or grab a hold of you at all. The ego will say, wow, you made a lot of progress. What kind of progress did you make? I'm really interested in this. I'm so great, happy for you. You made progress. I neither made progress, nor did I not make progress. I'm neither aware of progress, nor not aware of it. If someone says, well, you just met Jesus. Oh, that's great. I neither met Jesus nor did I not meet Jesus. Okay, now you may say this is a trick. You know, well, the ego will say that, you know. Well, say it's neither a trick nor is it not a trick. It's a little break, which I deserve. I have a right to take a little break from this because I was working on the continuity for as part of it. As part of repentance, you get to take a little break like this, full stop on the wow. And the ego says, well, I don't know, I understand that. Well, I'm neither responding to that, nor am I not responding to it. It's a trick. Well, I'm neither responding to that nor not responding to it. You're going to be anxious. I'm neither responding to that nor not responding to it. Or if you feel more assertive, you can say, yes, I am that perfect idiot. Yes, I am that perfect trickster. Yes, I'm already that perfect trickster. Yes, I'm already that perfect non-responder. You know, you could go with agree with the ego. It's another way, but also technique which keeps the neutralizes the ego. Neutralizes threats. You know, it's threatening. All it does is threaten, threaten, threaten. Bluff, bluff, bluff. Wow. What a great day. So it's hot enough where all the plants are starting to release their essences, you know, their fragrances, so you can smell the earth and the plants and everything. It's catch some fragrance on the breeze like this. That's why I love the heat. You know, the heat just liberates the essence, doesn't it, in some way. Everything has to expand in some way. So we're just going fabulous. Make sure you got your popcorn, your water, your lemonade, your ice cream. That's my diet I'm on right now. Potato chips, hot dogs, veggie dogs actually. If you're eating meat, I highly recommend, not pressure anyone, but you can go to veggie stuff, Morningstar brand. I think it's probably available almost about everywhere now. I think it's called Morningstar, yeah, and green, sort of a green packaging, but Kellogg's actually makes it. And their meat substitutes are absolutely fabulous. The hot dogs, the hamburgers, whatever, it just, you cannot hardly tell the difference. And it's so much healthier for you than eating meat. I mean, just hot dogs, I mean, it's just ground up, you know. Everything. What they put in hot dogs is just repulsive. I mean, it's horrible. But the veggie dogs, no, it's just, it's good for you, actually. And you think you're eating a hot dog, just put a lot of mustard on. You say, wow, this is a hot dog I'm eating. Now, they're not as greasy. They're not as big and thick and juicy and greasy. You know, so there's not quite that component. The old grease, the animal fat, you know, component. But they still have a flavor that it really, if you feel like, I'm not eating some tofu thing, I'm eating a hot dog. So that way you can go full July Americana, hot dog, lemonade, ice cream, potato chips, throw popcorn in there.